Leo Axt is going to tell us about ban nuclear weapons. Mit der Frieden-Nobelpreisträgerin unterwegs zum Atomwaffenverbot. It's written in German, but I'm going to tell you something about Yes, We Ban. The 2017 Nobel Peace Prize winner, ICAN, on the journey towards banning nuclear weapons. Nuclear weapons are back in the headlines, but that's a good thing. We may have forgotten about the danger, but the truth is nuclear weapons and the danger posed by them through accident, miscommunication, or by design, never disappeared. Now it's about the ban of nuclear weapons and why this is the first step to abolish them. Leo Axt is the EU representative of ICAN, the International Campaign to Abolish Nuclear Weapons, which won the Nobel Prize in 2017. Before moving to Brussels, Leo founded ICAN in Germany 2013, where he sits on the board. Since 2015, Leo also works for Transparency International in Brussels after 2 years working for the European Commission. So, I give you Leo. Please have some applause for Leo. Woohoo! Have fun.
Thanks a lot. Thanks a lot for the kind introduction, and thanks all and foremost for inviting ICAN to the Fusion for the second time, actually. So we were here in 2015. The Fusion always thought that ICAN was great, even before we won big prizes elsewhere. And so it's wonderful to be back and to speak about the last years and about this crazy journey that we have been through. So it's not an exaggeration to say that this has been like quite a crazy year, I would say. It was a bit of a disconnect because it feels like the world is going through a rough patch lately. So in 2017 was like this crazy guy taking over the United States and so on. It was kind of weird to, you know, be in a completely different reality where for us everything was just going great. Like we won the Nobel Peace Prize last year, so that was a pretty life-changing experience. And so we really had a wonderful time in ICAN. There was a number of things that led to this Nobel Prize, which was mainly the adoption in July of 2017 of a new treaty that makes nuclear weapons illegal under international law. How many people have heard that nukes are now illegal? So I see 5-6 people. Definitely have heard of the momentous news. Anyways, the treaty is not yet entered into force, so it's not international law yet, but we had plenty of reason to celebrate last year. And obviously, we've been working for this treaty for quite a few years, so, you know, to kind of adopt a new treaty under international law with like 130 countries voting in favor of this is not something that you can achieve in a short amount of time. And basically, what I wanted to talk about today is a bit of a personal journey as well, how we sort of stumbled into this whole ICAN business and how you kind of found an NGO in your living room and you kind of meet young and motivated people from all over the world that kind of hang out at boring conferences of the United Nations, putting on a suit and a tie and hanging out in those conference rooms in New York and in Geneva and so on, and just kind of meeting diplomats and trying to persuade them that this is totally the moment to go and ban nuclear weapons and they shouldn't wait. And so it's quite a hilarious story, I find, how that all sort of panned out and how most of the countries in the world were in the end of the conviction that nuclear weapons are illegal and unacceptable. So I prepared a bit of a presentation a while ago. This is more as a background, but I think probably nobody really knows ICAN, so this is it. We're basically it's a huge network of NGOs. It's quite difficult to kind of coordinate NGOs globally. I think that's a challenge that most organized civil society has, how to kind of be coherent across continents and countries, even if you don't have the funds to have offices everywhere and so on. So we have 468 partner organizations in like 101 countries. Can't say that they are all equally active and well-resourced, But we're definitely active in, I don't know, 30, 40 countries where we have very committed people. And we have a tiny little office in Geneva where we were down to 4 staff members. And then we didn't have much in Germany in 2013. So basically, we met all of these ICANN people at various conferences, and we just finished our studies, and they were like offering us to start ICANN in Germany as like a national chapter, national liaison office. And that seemed like an amazing idea. So basically, this is Jacob, my flatmate, and me. We had just moved back to Berlin from Dresden, and we spent half a year apart, and that kind of led to ICANN being started in Germany, because I was in New York for half a year. So there's this Republic of Nauru. Has anybody heard of the Republic of Nauru? It's like it's the tiniest UN member state, basically. They only have 9,000 inhabitants somewhere in the Pacific. Anyway, they don't have many diplomats, and they needed help on disarmament stuff because they had taken on additional responsibilities for all of the other island states. And so I became sort of their disarmament attaché for half a year. It was quite a fun experience. And obviously, it was a lot of nuclear weapons involved there. It was in New York in these negotiations. And my flatmate, he had been to Hiroshima with ICANN and then to Oslo, and they were kind of ferrying him around, showing him a bit the structures of ICANN internationally. And so we met again in 2013 in our flat share in Berlin, and it just seemed like the most natural thing to do, that this was going to be the moment when there was going to be, you know, some decisive movement towards actually, after decades of blockade, after decades of no progress at all on nuclear disarmament, after the nuclear weapon states making promises time and again, never actually implementing the commitments and so on, it seemed like the moment to really have a breakthrough and declare nuclear weapons illegal, no matter who is going to participate in this treaty, and to, in fact, empower the majority of, you know, the silent majority of states in the world that don't have nuclear weapons to really make their voices felt, because we all have a stake in this. It's not just the grown-ups, it's not just the 9 nuclear weapon states who should be negotiating disarmament among themselves. It's kind of ridiculous to wait for the smokers to start a smoking ban. So it's obvious that those states that don't have nuclear weapons, they have to find their voice, they have to assert their influence and make sure that the small number of nuclear weapon states feels their pressure to finally move and disarm and stop the dangers emanating from nuclear deterrence and hair trigger alert and all of these rather dangerous state of affairs. So that was basically the niche. We needed an actor in Germany, in the German political system, who would really trailblaze and advertise basically this concept of making nuclear weapons illegal, right? So this just doesn't happen by itself. You always need some people who are committed enough to kind of do the dirty work and go and push the message everywhere, even when you're not welcome, and even when people don't take you seriously and so on, to have somebody who really pushes the idea and has the commitment and is convinced that now is the moment to adopt a new treaty. It's always difficult to get new treaties through. There's always lots of ideas for new treaties, and you have to kind of get the international community behind you, no? And in Germany, well, there was a lot of NGOs on nuclear disarmament, obviously, but the old concept was kind of to try and make all of the nuclear weapon states sit down together and negotiate among themselves, you know, a nuclear weapons convention with all of the states of the world. But that involved waiting for the nuclear weapon states to actually sit down with you. So that sort of wasn't happening for many decades, in fact. So it was fairly obvious to us, at least, you know, unexperienced young people just coming out of university, that we needed like a new concept, and it made sense to us to just move ahead without the nuclear weapon states, change international law, change the rules of the game, make sure that everybody knows that nuclear weapons are illegal and unacceptable, and then from there, start with the difficult work of actually getting, you know, disarmament moving again. And something pretty amazing happened within 4 years of that. Basically, the international community agreed and came together, and in 2017, in 1 month of negotiations in New York, they adopted a treaty that makes nuclear weapons categorically illegal. That was adopted on the 7th of July of 2017, so that's the rather historic date. It's next week is actually the anniversary. And obviously, massive breakthrough. Unfortunately, and I overheard coming here that the last talk was in the G20, right? So on the same weekend as the treaty on the prohibition of nuclear weapons was adopted, you had the G20 in Hamburg. And it was absolutely impossible for us to get through in the media. Nobody would talk about the, you know, after 70 years, the United Nations has finally managed to declare nuclear weapons illegal. No, it was all about the G20, where like 20 nations had agreed on nothing at all. And 122 nations had agreed at the United Nations that the worst weapons in the history of the world have to be prohibited. So we felt that was rather more significant. And I think over the long term, even though, of course, it was difficult to kind of get through the fog and the disinterest in the media, in the long term, this is obviously going to have a much, much stronger impact. And one of the things that really made it easier for us to really play our role and advertise this treaty and get states on board and politicians who have no clue about this stuff and to get them to care about nuclear weapons again, it was really the Nobel Peace Prize helped a lot. I think it brought us, it advanced us by 10 years, basically. It really makes sure that people try and look for space to get the process forward. And this is probably the point where I should mention why we have to put on so much pressure. Because basically, we're in Germany right now. And Germany claims for itself the role of a trailblazer for nuclear disarmament. In fact, they say that they are super progressive, that they want a nuclear weapon-free world, and that they are doing everything in their power to kind of advance these goals. And that's hilarious, because, I mean, look, Germany boycotted the negotiations on the UN Treaty on the Prohibition of Nuclear Weapons. They still didn't sign it, and in fact, they're still saying that this is a shitty idea, you shouldn't do it, you shouldn't ratify it, and they're diverting attention and coming up with all kinds of really incongruous, illogical excuses why Germany shouldn't be participating in this. And that's kind of the plot twist here, that most of the European countries, and Germany in particular, are really fighting tooth and nail against the prohibition of nuclear weapons. I think most people would find that to be surprising, at least the politicians that I talk to and the journalists that I talk to. They have a really hard time understanding that their country, Germany, is really one of the forces that is protecting nuclear weapons and working against disarmament. So that's kind of a tough thing to swallow at first for them. But that's also where the ban treaty comes in. So we've been told by the Germans, now we don't want to do this. It's going to be meaningless and just symbolic and not going to have any good effects. But obviously, I mean, when you have Trump and North Korea threatening each other to kill millions of innocent civilians, it kind of makes sense that we should probably remind these people that they don't get to kind of increase their status by announcing that they're going to kill millions of people. But that the rest of the world really finds this to be completely appalling and unacceptable behavior, and I mean, you know, nuclear weapons are just completely illegitimate, and you shouldn't be proud of them. You should be ashamed of them, in fact. So it's fairly important to have this symbolic shift here. And nuclear weapons, often they say, no, they're not used on a daily basis. They're just used as a political symbol, and that makes sense to me in that we have to attack that symbol, and you do that by prohibiting them, by delegitimizing them, and that's also how you get them down from this pedestal of conferring legitimacy and power in the international system of states. Now, of course, we've seen Trump meeting Kim, for example, and for Kim, this was a nice opportunity to show, hey, we're back in the community of states, and now we're accepted in the club of the cool nations with nuclear weapons and so on. It's better to meet and talk, I suppose, than to threaten each other to annihilate the other country. So that's already something. But you can do better, I think. So the most important effect maybe of the ban treaty is that it basically stops this ambiguity where states like Germany, actually all nations in NATO, get to claim that they are working for nuclear disarmament while clearly on the ground, on the facts, trying to do everything they can to slow down the process. And it makes it glaringly obvious that Germany is boycotting this treaty, so that even the journalists and the politicians that don't deal with this on a day-by-day basis, they figure out, hey, okay, well, they've been lying to us. These people are not working on nuclear disarmament. In fact, they're not even able to sign a symbolic treaty on the prohibition of nuclear weapons. So obviously, we have to do a lot of pressure here on those states. Here we have a map of Europe. There's a bunch of states that are supporting the treaty and a bunch that don't. It's quite funny. Europe has like a split. There's really abstentions in favor and against, completely all over the map. But that's fine. I mean, this is the whole strategy behind the ban treaty, is that when you can't get everybody on board, you start with what you have, and then you take it from there and you try to improve from there. So obviously, making nuclear weapons illegal is not going to get rid of the nuclear weapons overnight. But it really makes sense to have this kind of clear goal in mind to really be on the same page and say, okay, nuclear weapons are illegal, unacceptable, have to be gotten rid of. And of course, it's the same also on the domestic level. Now we have made murder illegal. That doesn't mean it doesn't happen anymore, but it happens a lot less because there's consequences attached to it, and you know that you're not supposed to kill people. So I think we have to do the same on the international level, and states have to stop wielding nuclear weapons because this is rather dangerous as a game. So the first step was obviously to get all of the states that don't have nuclear weapons on board. And that was actually quite difficult because these happen to be the states in the global south, so they have a lot less resources for their foreign ministries, they have less diplomats in the various conferences, they don't necessarily follow all of the topics. So the Republic of Nauru, this island state that I was working for, was the first time they had been working on disarmament. They never really had anybody working on disarmament. So how do you get all of these states, you know, to find their voice and rally the numbers and really tell the handful of nuclear weapon states that the vast majority of states is no longer tolerating their behavior? Well, we really had to kind of empower these states one by one, get a few states that agreed with us, and then do the dirty work for these states, kind of going really door to door, trying to convince each and every member state, going through all the capitals. And this way we sort of got 130 states, so it's the vast majority of the world. But of course the states, the rich ones, the industrialized world, the Western world, that's the states that we didn't get. So we didn't get the nuclear weapon states, nor did we get anybody from NATO, nor did we get Australia, South Korea, Japan. So these are really the richest country on earth. Richest countries on earth, they really were opposed to this entire treaty because they rely on nuclear weapons from the United States. So basically, America has promised all of these states that they are going to defend them with their own nuclear weapons, and therefore, obviously, they can't go and delegitimize nuclear weapons in a ban treaty unless they first negotiate with the United States that, hey, by the way, if we're going to be attacked with nuclear weapons, please don't retaliate. We're going to be dead anyways. We don't care. You don't need to end the human race just because Germany was attacked in a nuclear attack. So that's going to be the next step. We have to get all of these NATO states that have so far not agreed with the prohibition of nuclear weapons, we have to get them to join this treaty, and they are going to be in a much better position to obviously put pressure on France, UK, the Americans within NATO, and then, of course, via the nuclear weapon states, also on everybody else worldwide. And the whole point here is that we sort of agree on the long-term goal, but it's really difficult to implement all of these steps. And we think that the ban treaty is really the super breakthrough that happened last year, which is really going to allow us to put a lot more pressure on a lot of really obvious things that should be done, that, you know, have been out there for decades and have simply not been implemented yet. And these are really quite straightforward. So the Russians and the Americans, they are able to fire off 1,000, 1,500 nuclear weapons each within about 15 minutes. So to just de-alert those weapons, make sure that they can't be fired, you know, at the push of a button, would already make it a lot less dangerous enterprise. Now, we have had thousands of accidents actually involving nuclear weapons. So the United States alone have lost around 50 nuclear weapons in the sea with various planes that crash left and right. For decades, they actually had for 24/7, 365 days a year, they were circling with planes outside the Soviet Union, and Soviet planes were circling outside Alaska so that they could like fly into the enemy territory within a few hours and attack everywhere. So, I mean, the level of psycho mind games where you actually have like dozens upon dozens of planes 24/7 circling outside your frontier, loaded with nuclear weapons, ready to kind of end the human race completely. This is what we've been through in the 70s and 80s, and obviously if you have planes in the air like the entire year round, a lot of them crash, and that happened a lot. I mean, that's how they lost so many of these weapons. But then also lots of other stuff happens. Like, these are very demotivated soldiers. We have 15,000 nuclear weapons right now in the entire world. And 15,000 nuclear weapons, they have to be cleaned, moved around, maintained. The soldiers who are doing this stuff, they actually they know that there's no career to be had in nuclear weapons. So, I mean, they're never really going to use them. They actually fail a lot of the tests. We have had leaks where it shows that there's a lot more spousal abuse, a lot more tests failed among those soldiers that deal with nuclear weapons, simply because they are really stuck in those silos for months, and really even worse if you're on a submarine for months and you can't go up from the water, and your only job is basically to sail the seas and figure out whether or not you should send off nuclear weapons that will kill millions of people. I mean, you know, you can imagine this is kind of a shitty job. So a lot of accidents happen the entire time. Like, they just don't follow protocol. The infrastructure is really bad from the 70s, 80s. These are just shitty old weapon systems. And if you have 15,000 of them lying around, it's quite messy. I mean, obviously, there's going to be a lot of accidents. The only numbers we know are from the UK and the US. You can imagine that in Russia, in Pakistan, in China, they also probably have a lot of accidents with nuclear weapons, but we just don't find out about those, right? So it's fairly obvious, as long as nuclear weapons exist, that they will be used at some point by accident, by miscalculation, or by design. If the probability of something not happening is not zero, then it will eventually happen if the timeline is infinite. So I think it's absolutely irresponsible to keep nuclear weapons around. On top of that, if you want to deter your enemy, so they say they're not going to use their nuclear weapons because it's only for deterrence, if you want to deter them, you have to make it super credible that you're actually going to nuke the others, right? So you have to, like, always be with the finger on the button so that it's super credible that with an incoming missile, you're immediately going to send hundreds of missiles on the other side. And that's just crazy stuff. I mean, if you send, like, 100 nuclear weapons, you already generate so much smoke in the atmosphere that 1 to 2 billion people would not die from the effects of the nuclear weapon itself, but 1 to 2 billion people would starve to death because there would be so much smoke in the atmosphere, 10% less sunlight, and this would have global consequences for, well, the most impoverished states in the world. They would be the ones who would have to carry the most consequences. So this is fairly urgent. I think our ambassadors, Trump and Kim Jong-un, have made a good deal of advertisement for the fact that nuclear disarmament is still necessary, that nuclear weapons are still around. That was the end of the Cold War. We still are exposed to these risks and dangers every day. And now it's about really making sure that the European states kind of find their voice. They've just been slapped in the face with the Iran deal, where Trump, for no reason whatsoever, just killed the Iran agreement and created, like, a major headache in the Middle East. We might have another proliferation crisis and so on. So it's quite important for the Europeans to find their voice and to really assert that nuclear disarmament is important also from their perspective. And of course, try and save the Iran deal, but also try and convince the United States that, well, you don't have to have nuclear deterrence if you're going to be in NATO, and the European states can totally sign this treaty as well. That's what we're working on. It's quite an uphill battle. NATO is basically employing fake news tactics to keep us from achieving this goal of having Germany and all of the others sign this treaty. Basically, what they're saying is that NATO and nuclear weapons is one and the same and inseparable, and if you're going to be in NATO, then of course you have to base yourself on weapons of mass destruction. We kind of beg to differ, but it's kind of difficult if the entirety of NATO claims that, yeah, nuclear weapons are really at the core of their mission. We say that it's not in the treaties, and there's all the technical arguments around it. At the end of the day, you can totally be flexible even within NATO. You don't even have to get rid of NATO, even though, of course, that's another thing that many people would like to see happen. But now we're kind of trying to get NATO on the same page there. It's a painful task. We have the NATO summit in a few weeks in Brussels. Trump and all the others are going to show up in Brussels. We're going to be there to kind of, you know, make all of these arguments to them that we're not a threat to NATO, whatever, and that NATO doesn't have to threaten weapons of mass destruction in order to keep themselves safe. And let's see how that will go. So I think I've already talked for way too long. Maybe if there's questions from the audience, we can take it in a direction that's more geared towards your interests. How much time do we have?
10 minutes.
10 minutes.
No, 20.
20 minutes.
So if there are any questions, I can give you the microphone. Is anyone here?
Thanks very much. I was just wondering if you would say that the main reason why Germany didn't say no to atomic weapons is that they are also in NATO, or is there more behind this? What's the motivation?
So originally there was a different motivation, basically the conservative party of Germany, the CDU, they wanted nuclear weapons in the 50s and 60s, but they didn't have coalition partners who would let them do it, and then there was like the whole negotiation was in NATO, and then basically the Americans came up with the idea, hey, how about we station a fuck ton of nuclear weapons in Germany, then they're going to be happy. That's what they did. And in Eastern Germany, they also stationed a lot of nuclear weapons there. It dawned on nobody that obviously the nuclear weapons would be used here, and it's like a shitty idea to have them in the first place. Right now, no, I mean, I think the vibe I'm getting, quite frankly, I think the politicians, they would be fine with doing something against nuclear weapons. The diplomats understand our arguments. They understand that we are, you know, that this is intellectually coherent, that you can't claim nuclear weapons for yourself and then sit down with Iran and tell them that they don't have the right to do the same thing. I mean, this is a bankrupt strategy. You have to ban nuclear weapons for everybody. That's fairly obvious. So I think the apparatus, you know, they would go along with that. And the only issue is indeed NATO. So, and again, I mean, NATO is the treaty founding NATO doesn't mention nuclear weapons at all. But the strategic concept of NATO mentions nuclear weapons. And that's like a political document. So unlike the treaty, it's not legally binding. But of course, it's something that's politically binding, as adapted every few years. So every 10 years, roughly, you have a new strategic concept. The current one declares NATO a nuclear alliance for as long as nuclear weapons exist. But at the same time, it also commits all NATO member states to working towards creating the conditions for a nuclear weapon-free world. So that would be coherent with banning nuclear weapons, because prohibiting nukes is obviously a condition for a nuclear weapon-free world. So you can also make it sound coherent. That's not what NATO is doing. They're basically saying that nuclear deterrence is at the core of the alliance. There was a few attempts also by the Germans in 2010, for example, to get rid of the nuclear weapons here in Germany. There's 20 of them stationed in Büchel in Rheinland-Pfalz. And that went very well. There was the Westerwelle was the foreign minister at the time who was really pushing this as a personal topic of his. But then NATO was indeed quite opposed. There was Hillary Clinton as the foreign minister back then, Secretary of State, who poured cold water over the idea of withdrawing the nukes. And since then, well, it's a bit of a touchy subject, basically. So what we're trying to do is put enough pressure on the German political system, the politicians in charge, the government, and the MPs, and of course the foreign ministry, so that they saying, okay, fine, we're going to have to go to NATO, we're going to have to confront them with these awkward questions, we're going to have to go through all of these difficult negotiations, you know, we're going to have to say, look, we want to not be part of the nuclear planning group anymore, we want to not take part in the nuclear exercises, we want to negotiate a formal opt-out from nuclear deterrence. You can imagine it's a bit of a hassle. People will not necessarily cooperate very quickly in this endeavor. Especially now with Trump as the US president, the political level would be very concerned that they might be provoking the crazy guy, right? So if you tell them, hey, we don't want your nukes anymore, but otherwise, please keep on protecting us, thank you very much. You have to kind of find a way to say this in such a way that you don't kind of call into question your overall loyalty to NATO, right? So that's important now with Germany spending quite a not so much on defense as NATO partners would like to, right? Germany is being criticized a lot for NATO's military spending. And so on top of that, to then also kind of delegitimize nuclear weapons in such a way, they have to find the courage to do that. And we have to put enough pressure on them so that they feel, okay, it's easier to go the route of confronting NATO rather than to keep on telling to our population that we are working for nuclear disarmament while boycotting it on the whole line, right? So we're going to have to make it painful enough, this blatant lie, and basically towards the general population and also towards the politicians. I mean, the most members of parliament, they don't think so much about nuclear weapons, and they believe that they are on the good side.
Do we have more questions for Leo? Here we go.
Hi, thanks for the talk. I'm assuming that some states are prohibit in the in favor of like banning nuclear weapons, and also in the meantime violating human rights really badly. So I'm wondering if ICANN has alliances or like does advocacy with such states. If yes, how does it work? And isn't it paradoxical with the whole like peace building situation to, if yes, like work with states who don't respect human rights at all and who also want to ban nuclear weapons? Thanks.
Right, so the first important angle here is indeed human rights, and I would extend that to international humanitarian law. So that's kind of the baseline law that you have to respect even during the wars. The like not killing civilians and stuff like that. And that was actually one of the main angles for ICANN to do its work, was to basically force states to look at nuclear weapons in a new light, to not see them as like an abstract concept, you know, something that plays a role in deterrence theory, you know, like mind games, and we have so many nukes and then you're not going to attack and so on, but rather to look at nuclear weapons as physical devices, as actual machines in the real world, and if they, and they are designed, they're optimized to kill as many people as possible. That's just what they are. So to really describe them as physical machines in the physical realm and describe the consequences of what they do. And this was also a good way to enroll the cooperation, partnership, and help of humanitarian organizations like the Red Cross societies, like Médecins Sans Frontières, Greenpeace, Amnesty, lots of human rights organizations, Oxfam, and really get like a stronger foothold to lobby for this ban treaty. Then, of course, cooperation with states. You basically cooperate with any state that is going to be in favor of your idea, right? So you kind of go around with lists of all of the member states of the United Nations and you check them off one by one because you want to have as many as possible. And you don't really care, you know, what system of government they have. In most of the cases, you don't even know. I mean, you know, there's 193 UN member states and you don't stop to endeavor, you know, every time what are they up to. But in the end, the states that we really cooperated so deeply with were basically Austria. So Austria was actually our champion state on banning nuclear weapons. Norway as well. Then Switzerland, Mexico, South Africa, and also Brazil, Argentina, Indonesia. These were kind of the states. So there was no obvious tyrant. The one that I usually have to think of is Kazakhstan. They really hate nuclear weapons. they've had like a lot of tests during the Soviet Union times and a lot of irradiated territory. A lot of civilians from Kazakhstan have very bad deformations, and there's a lot of victims from nuclear testing across Kazakhstan. And for them, this is kind of a way to rebrand them in the international community as standing for something progressive, something positive, you know, something in the vein of human rights. They have given up nuclear weapons that were lying around in Kazakhstan when they seceded from the Soviet Union. So they technically were nuclear weapon states and gave back the weapons to Russia. So they have like a bit of a moral high ground there. They've done the right thing. They are a victim of nuclear weapons, and then now they try to use this also to kind of greenwash themselves. So I mean, on the one hand, it's clearly legitimate for them to do this. They have suffered a lot under nuclear weapons, but it's a bit, yeah, it's not nice to see such a government, you know, kind of trumpeting this topic for the wrong reasons maybe. But they also ratified already the Treaty on the Prohibition of Nuclear Weapons. So they are definitely continue to do the right thing. And in terms of putting pressure on all of the nuclear weapon states to disarm, it really doesn't matter if they are democracies or not. We have to get as many states as possible. And in fact, we also have to get the nuclear armed states which are not democracies. So often we get the argument that only democracies will be convinced by this, you know, soft, wishy-washy, nuclear weapons are illegal and immoral. But I don't think that's true, actually. I think that dictatorships also want to survive. They also can be rational and assess a strategic situation differently depending on the situation. So if you look at China, they only have 300 nuclear weapons, whereas the US, the democracy, has, what, 8,000. That doesn't make sense. That's completely irrational. And yet, this is where we are. So I really think that you have to work with, you know, it's obviously so much easier to work in democracies. Like in China, we don't even have a partner in China because, I mean, you can't go and campaign for nuclear disarmament in China. You're going to be a dissident. You're going to be it's in a tough spot, I would say.
Do we have more questions? Here we go.
Thank you for hearing me. In my eyes, it seems to me that being a member of the NATO has a major impact in how far you feel committed to the NPT, for example, and how far you have a red or a green mark on the European card map. And I wonder how you guys from ICAN interact or communicate to the NATO as a UN member besides the conferences in Geneva or New York. Thank you.
Thanks. So, yeah, I'm kind of the guy in Brussels for ICAN who also has to pick up much of the NATO stuff and the direct meetings when you need somebody in town and so on. So I have to admit we haven't so far been incredibly well connected with NATO officials and NATO conferences and processes, but it's getting a lot better. So a few of our partner organizations already a few years back had good contacts and were kind of trying to come up with the policy documents and the analysis, you know, stating that NATO shouldn't be a problem if they kind of just develop a bit of flexibility there. And now since the Nobel Peace Prize, I really have to say it's a huge difference. It's much easier to get all of these contacts. Suddenly we're being invited to the NATO conferences to speak there. So we were at the Munich Security Conference in Munich in February, which is kind of weird. Lots of security policy people, everybody loves nuclear weapons. And suddenly they have to invite us to kind of come there and crash their party and tell them that that sucks. No? So that's good. It's not always fun to go to those conferences, but it's good to go and tell them the version of the vast majority of states of the world. And now the same was the NATO summit in Brussels. We've been invited to the entire engagement conference, whatever. So there also we get to then state our position on these matters and really enrich the discussion that they have so that they also get the other side. And, you know, in private conversations, I think most diplomats would agree that within 5 to 15 years, you know, a third, maybe a half of NATO states would probably join the ban treaty. So I completely agree that NATO is the main problem for those states in terms of joining the treaty. It has, as you said, major impacts also on their behavior in the NPT. So the NPT Article 1 and 2 says, okay, you shouldn't receive nuclear weapons, and Article 2 is you shouldn't give anybody nuclear weapons. And US gave nuclear weapons to Belgium, Netherlands, Italy, Turkey, and Germany. So fairly obvious and blatant, the violation of the NPT. They always claim that this is the sacred, you know, nuclear disarmament instrument, when actually it says nuclear non-proliferation in the title, so not handing them on is kind of not the same thing as disarmament. So there's just, you know, a lot of logical flaws here. They claim that in the NPT you can negotiate everything. Well, in the NPT you only have 5 out of 9 nuclear weapon states. So clearly the NPT is not the answer. You need a fair instrument that treats everybody the same, like the ban treaty.
Who's going to be next? No more questions? Leo, no more questions. Well, great. Thank you very much, and I guess that's your applause.
I forgot to say there's like a lot of information material in front if you want to know more about ICAN or how you can get engaged with the German chapter. And if you want to speak with more ICAN people, there's even Birte here, who's on the board of ICAN Germany. So if you have other questions and so on, we would be hanging around here and happy to discuss.